thanks you and Sarah for the invitation. Very pleasure to be here with you. So just a short introduction about me. I'm Marco Drago. I am now working in Rome as a Insights researcher. I am a member of the Virgo collaboration since more than 10 years now. And my main work in the Virgo collaboration is about the data analysis of the detectors, in of course also the LIGO one. And the main topic is analyzing the data for the type of search that we speak in the talk, where we don't have a particular model for the waveform that we expect. So we are open to every type of signal that we can get. So just start the talk. I saw that in the first meeting of this seminar, there was Alex speaking about gravitational wave and compact binary coalescence. So I will go fast in the introduction. Just remind, we are speaking about gravitational waves that are obtained by solving the Einstein equation with a linear approximation. And it's easy to solve the equation when we are in the what is called the transverse traceless gauge. So it means that the wave have only spatial component and are transverse. And what is happening is that the solution is a sort of wave where we have two independent components that are called the polarization, usually labeled with H plus and H cross. And the effect is the one that you can see in the GIF that are modifying the distances along the two perpendicular direction. And when one is stretched, the other is enlarged and the opposite. And the difference between the two polarizations is just an angle of 45 degrees. So how we can generate gravitational wave? We just need a mass energy tensor that is at least quadrupolar. So also the motion of the masses should be quadrupolar. So the typical example is a binary system, but it can happen also if there is a singular system that the process is not symmetric. So an example could be like a neutron star that turn around, or it can be some cases also supernova explosion if the explosion is not perfectly symmetric as a sphere. As already Alex said to you in the collaboration, we usually identify four type of sources according to the way we try to search for them. And in this talk, we will speak about the second one, the one that we call the not model burst. So it means that our transient limited in time, that we don't know exactly what is the waveform shape. We can make some modelization, but the modelization maybe is not characterizing all the type of sources that we had. It is possible that even if we are not searching for compact binary coalescence, they enter in this set. So this type of algorithm that search for this signal, they can also detect the compact binary coalescence. They are not really devoted to this, but it can happen. As you know, the amplitude spectrum is very low because the amplitude of the gravitational wave is very, very, very faint. So you need to have very powerful instruments that are the interferometers that are built in this in a way that there are these two arms and the laser go in this arm. And the fact that the gravitational wave is coming from different part of the sky, the projection of the different length modification of the arm depends on where the gravitational wave is coming. So this is taking account of what is called the antenna pattern that I didn't report in this formula here, but they just depend which is the orientation of the source sky. So according to the orientation, the this what is called the detector response can be different. In particular, if the source is the gravitational wave is coming from the B sector, the detector is blind because the effect is the same in the two arms. And if it's coming from the direction orthogonal to the plane, the effect is maximum. So we know we have now the two LIGO interferometer working operation. There is Virgo in Italy, that is also French, Italian, and other collaboration in Europe. Kagra just started to take data at the end of the last run, and India is planned, and there is also GEO in Germany that is used also to more to test the prototype for make the new things like the other detectors. And now we are here in this part, so we have been three runs for the advanced detector. Every time we start a new run, the idea is to have a better sensitivity. And this is usually expressed in this way. So this is the typical sensitivity that we can expect in the build of interferometer. You can see that more or less is similar to ROADM, and the most region sensitivity is this one. That is the one near of binary neutron star and black hole. And usually we define this what is called the binary neutron star range. That is the distance of which you can see a binary neutron star of this masses with an SNR of 8 in a single detector. And this is just a sort of idea of how much you are improving your sensitivity. It's not a complete value of every type of source in the can happen, but just to have a rough idea if you are improving or not. So you can see that this number increase as you are increasing the time of the run. So far, elements have been detected in the first two runs and the first half of the third run, because the second half is still in process. Hope will come out soon. And so you have seen there is a huge bunch of binary black hole, a small number of binary neutron star, and there are also some events that are the merging of a black hole and something that can be a neutron star for sure, or something that we are not really sure because the mass is in a particular mass range where you are not really sure is a black hole or a neutron star. And you know that this is the typical binary coalescence where the signal was already explained by Alex in the last call, so in the last meeting, so I don't want to go in details, but the typical feature is everything the same for all this. Maybe the time duration and the frequencies can be different because depend on the masses. So let's start with the gravitational wave data analysis. When you are analyzing the data, in principle, what you apply is what is called the hypothesis test. So the idea is that at each time, there could be a gravitational wave there or there could be not. And then you can use what is called a decision rule that just tell you according to some algorithm or some idea if you think that the signal is there or not. Of course, you can be right or wrong because you can say that the signal is there when it is, or you can see a signal when it's not and the opposite. So if you combine this different situation, we have two situations when you are right and two situations that are wrong. And the idea is that you can change your decision rule to change the number of times you make the wrong or right. So there is a criterion, it's called the Nyman-Pearson criterion, that if you have to take the best decision rule, is the one that gives the greater number of true alarms respect to the same number of false alarms. So if we want to have the best efficiency in our search, we just need to measure these two quantities and see when we are getting this number very high. So how we can measure this? The true alarm is calculating, just taking a fake gravitational wave and summing this fake gravitational wave in the data of the detector, and then apply your decision rule. And when you see, you just count how many times you see this original injected signal, to calculate your efficiency. Of course, the efficiency can be also distinguished because according to the gravitational wave parameters, so like what is the distance that you expect, what is the frequency, then can be, I don't know, like if we take a supernova signal, the efficiency can be different according to the different mass of the progenitor or something like that. So you can also characterize your true alarm or efficiency according to every parameter you are interested. You just need to make enough injection. Instead, for a false alarm, this is a little tricky. Because the fact is that considering a simple example of two detectors, but it can quite easily extend it to more, every detector is possible that sometimes there are some glitches, what we call, so it's just noise excesses that mimic gravitational wave. Of course, you know that since the theory say that gravitational waves travel at the speed of light, you can have that two possible, let's say, trigger in this case, can mimic also a gravitational wave if they are in coincidence between the delay time between the two detectors that fall the two limits on M for just 10 milliseconds. So this can be a true gravitational wave, and this in principle not. But how do you know if it is really true statistically, or if it can be just two random noises that for chance they are in coincidence? And for this is, to know this, you apply what is called the time shift. So you just shift one of the two detectors, it's invariant between one of the two, of a time that is really big compared to the 10 milliseconds. And then you apply again your decision rule. So in this case, this fake coincidence is just obtained with an original time that is bigger than the expected time of the detector. So this is for true, a fake coincidence. So this is another representation of the original data, but this can be used to make statistics. So if you repeat this time shift thousand and thousand of times, and you count how many times you get fake coincidence, you can estimate what is the probability that the original one is true or not. So there are four transient gravitational wave. Usually there are two type of searches, as I already told. The first one on the left we already covered in the past meeting talk. So now we speak about the second one. And this is what is called the search without any model. So when you know what you are searching for, you just make a sort of matching filter and you get out the results of the matching filter. Of course, there are other tricks to make the best way to do this, but the original idea is this. If you don't have any model, there is no way to make a matching filter. So the idea is that you use what is called an excess power technique. So you search in your data when there is a noise coming up and from there is some excess of noise coming up, and you just analyze them. Then a good way is to take different detectors to combine in a coherent way the excess power, like with a likelihood, to consider in a more coherent way what are the information. And then you have your detection statistics, that is your decision rule, that compared to the time shift that we have got in the previous case, just give you the significance of the detection. Another important thing is the source localization, because you want to know, if it is possible, where the signal is coming from. And the main way to calculate the sky position is by triangulation of the different time. So if you have two detectors, the triangulation gives an area, a circle in the sky that is possible to come. And if you also use the antenna pattern, you can in principle exclude some zone in the sky that are not compatible with the antenna pattern. So the combination of the two give a hint of usually an area that is not a complete circle where the source can become. Of course, if you make more detector, you combine the different circle from the more detector, you can reach a unique point. Discounting the fact that, of course, the noise make it difficult to do this. But this is just explaining for you that some of the sky location that we had for the first detectors, you can see that some of them have this half circle, and other have like point in the sky. And the difference is that when we have the circle, half circle, only two detectors were operative, but when you have three detectors, you can see that you can decrease a lot. And this is important also for what is called the follow-up project, the fact that as soon as the detector collects the data, you can estimate a rough sky localization given to electromagnetic or neutrino partners to see if they can see coincidence other messenger. And the effect of this, we know that was the GW15 or 917. It was the first time gravitational wave detecting coincidence with electromagnetic. But I suppose you already know the story. So let's go in detail about the bus searches. So I already give you the motivation why we want to do this, because up to now we have only detected binary system, but fortunately, luckily, universe of gravitational wave is not only binary system. So like supernova, maybe something associated with gamma ray burst or fast radio burst, some flares by neutron star or magnetar. So there are a lot of possibilities. But since we don't have a model for this mechanism, or sometimes the model can be quite not complete, like a supernova, you can get after months and months of calculation, you can get the signature for one particular case. But imagine how many cases you can have for the supernova. So you must be ready for everything. And this is what is called burst. So we search for what we don't know. So I usually identify three challenges when you search for the burst. The first one is the detection. So get a real signal. And we already see what are the problems. The second one is identify which type of source once you get it. So you need to reconstruct the waveform shape to get a reverse engineering and understand the process that has generated. When you search for swamp binary collection, you know there are that. But if you get one signal of burst, you have to understand which type of it is. And also, of course, sky localization help also in this case, because if you see also in this case a counterpart, that could help you to understand everything. A huge problem for the interferometer is that you have a lot of transient noise of what we call glitches that happen and are given by different reasons. And a first way to discard about this, this is an example of the times coming and the trigger rate with different SNR. You have a lot of what is called auxiliary channels. So they just record instrument behavior, environmental condition, just to see if there are some coupling because of this monitoring and the gravitational wave channel. And in case you see some coupling, you can just discard the time that you know that there are some disturbances. This type of noise can be of two types usually, can be not correlated between the detectors. So if a different detector can be just for chance and not correlated, an earthquake or some human noise or something like that. And also can be correlated. So it can happen also in coincidence between the two detectors. One example can be a cosmic ray shower. It is unlikely to produce a coincident observation, but just in case there is a cosmic ray detector at Hanford, for instance. So just to take care of everything that cause disturbances. And the effect of applying this data quality, so in these figures here, that this is the data for a part of the first line. And this distribution, the different color, is the distribution of the detection statistic of one algorithm that you can see. From black to yellow is applying this cleaning of the data. So what you understand from this is that if you don't clean at all, and this is the detection statistic of the first gravitational wave event, GW15 or 914, the significance of this event without cleaning will be very low compared to the one after you clean the data with these things. So you know it's better to try to increase your significance. Sometimes this is not enough. So in the burst search, it's possible that you classify the signal that you get or the trigger according to the morphology. So I didn't say in detail, but for instance, in the advanced detector, we discover a new type of glitch that are called blip. that they have a very clear waveform shape in the time frequency, but there is no clear correlation of the origin of this. So we don't have an idea to discard in principle. But if we identify this type of morphology, we can just put in a class that we call the class of blip. And then this apply paying a trial factor for how many classes you get, you can at least try to increase the possibility for real signal coming in the less noisy class. So the one that is very dirty, you will pay the trial factor and it's quite improbable to see something. But the other, well, the significant, well, they are not so dirty, they are more clean, is possible to get a real detection. Remember that you just pay a trial factor of 3, but it's cool. Even better than a factor of 10, considering all the sets in one unit. There are two types of searches when you take the burst, because sometimes you can have information from other messengers. So it is the opposite way of the example that we did for GW517 on H17. So like supernova, there are a neutrino signal or an electromagnetic signal from supernova. So it's possible to say we know that there has been a supernova at that time. So just search at the time and you limit the search around a typical window that depends on the supernova process. Or like for the gamma ray burst, in that case, you know the time and also the sky position. So you can restrict the search according to this information. And this is a huge way to limit your background glitches, because when you restrict some information, the main power is to restrict the background. If you don't have this information, you just do what is the blind search. So you search all the time, all the sky, where the detector are operative. And I just report some example of this that you can also specialize your type of search with parameter according to what you expect. So for instance, there is a search for what I call the short, like less than 1 second, or what I call the long transient, which seems quite funny to say long and transient in the same sentence, but it's just to say we try to increase something more than 100 seconds. Or like a binary backhaul that are with a eccentric orbit, because for that way it's possible to get similar results to the templates, because there are not enough templates to explain this, or like magnetar, or if there are other ideas, of course you can do this. An important thing is, I already told you that you want to know the waveform as they are. So since you don't have templates, it is not easy to reconstruct the two polarization at the origin, but you can reconstruct the detector response. So usually the burst algorithm reconstruct the projection of the two polarization for each detector. So this is the example for the first event, where there are Enfold and Livingston, and you can see that these are two different algorithms that reconstruct more or less similar. And also, if you reconstruct a CBC signal, a compact binary coalesce, you can also verify if your model reconstruction is fitting the template reconstruction to see if you have problem of reconstructing this. So there are different algorithms explain that. And it's impossible to explain all of them. I just want to give a short detail about the coherent wave burst. It's one of them. I just choose this because it's the one that I work and it's the one that I know better. But this is just the reason because I choose this algorithm. So just to show you a way when you can do this. So this is just a flowchart of CWB, but it's quite more similar to the one that I showed you in some slide before. So just skip and go in detail. First of all, what you need is to make what is called data conditioning. Why? Because this is the typical spectrum of the sensitivity. And you can see two things that are quite annoying for the bus. There are a lot of lines that are called persistent line that can be caused by power electric or motion of the mirror, something like that. And of course, it's not uniform in frequency. So if you make an excess power threshold, this is the way you do this. And what survive to the threshold are particle lines and things to the frequency where you are less sensitive. So the first thing is that you have to clean the line in some way. And this is done what is called the line prediction filter or regression. And then you whiten the data because you want to have the frequency amplitude the same for all the frequency spectrum. So in this way, all the frequencies are the same and you can try to make the excess power. In CWB, the line filter is done what is called with regression. Without going too much in detail, that is that you can use the auxiliary channel I was speaking before to predict the contribution of, let's say, auxiliary channel to the gravitational channel and subtract these disturbances. So this is an example of a power line with the side bends. And then knowing the auxiliary channel, you can just clean the power line and the side bends. So from the red, you go to the black one. And in principle, since you are taking information from not the gravitational wave, if there is a gravitational wave here, it should survive this cleaning. Another important thing is that usually we use a time frequency transformer because we want to know when it's happening, but we want also to know if the frequency of this trigger of signal is located in some particular frequency band. So we want to know these two things together at the same time. And usually in CWB for this, we use a wavelet transform. So why a wavelet transform? For different reasons. Because if you choose the right wavelet, you can have a low spectral leakage, and then you can also localize the transient. But in this another way, the wavelet transform allows you to use more what is called the composition level. What does it mean? When you have the total data are sample with a sample of 16 kilohertz. So this means that for each sample, you are characterizing the amplitude, the energy at this particular time resolution given by your sample rate and the frequencies, all the frequency of the signal. But using wavelet, you can change the composition level. And every time you increase your decomposition level, you are improving your frequency resolution and the time resolution is getting worse. But in this case, you have more possibility to describe your signal. And then every representation of a different level is independent and complete. So in principle, you can choose what is the level that you prefer at the time and make your characteristics. So here, there is just an example that was injected a fake signal. And it's not so easy to see, but the signal is more or less here. You can see that the amplitude that is given by the color, I didn't put the axis, but the yellow and the red are more located this time. There is also another thing, it is possible if you use multiple time frequency transformation with different solutions at the same time, maybe the signal could vary in the time frequency plane that different the composition level can adapt to different parts of the signal. So this is what we call the multi-resolution analysis. So including different time frequency pixels from different resolution to better characterize your signal. So just this is just a fake example of a compact binary collection that in principle can use different decomposition to characterize different time. After you got this, it's possible that you got like more time frequency, what is called pixel, come out from the noise. These are the excess power. If they are enough near, you can combine in what is called a cluster. Then in this cluster of the different detector, you construct your what is the likelihood. And the likelihood, without making too many formula, it's just the ratio between the probability of having a signal with the probability of not having a signal. And this part is supposing that the noise is Gaussian, so it's just a Gaussian distribution. This is not, of course, really true in the sense that the noise is very far from Gaussian, but the non-Gaussianity of noise is studied after with the time shift. So even if you don't have a real noise model, you can study this with the time shift approximation. And the signal model is just the fact that the data subtracted by the hypothetic signal is Gaussian itself. And then you, of course, you can make the calculation and the way is that you maximize this likelihood ratio according to the different mesh solution in the sky of each plus and each cross. Getting the maximum, you define, this is quite complicated, you define what is your best solution. Another important thing to take in account is that we know that detectors are blind for some location in the sky. And so sometimes you can forget that even if you have like three detectors, like in the last run, is for some region in the sky, you don't have effectively three detectors, but you have like two. So this means that between two and three detectors is better to take in account because the solution of the likelihood formula is more tricky for two detectors instead of three. So if you have only two detectors, just know in a priori, so you just apply this difference. But if you have three, you have to take in account that for some region in the sky, the effective number is not three but two. So what we do in CWB is what we call the regulator. We take in account of some region in the sky, the effective number is two, and then we have this regulator to take in account this and better have a better rejection of glitches. Then using your likelihood calculated from the sky, you can get a source localization. So the maximum likelihood position given where you think is the source direction. And then you can also put a threshold. This is a 3D representation of the same figure. If you put a threshold of your likelihood estimator, you can like say the probability of having the region of having like 90% or 50% of the signal, the probability in this region of the sky. So if you don't trust really the location that you give, you can just an area when there is a probability to get the signal, the original signal. And this is what is passed also in low latency to the electromagnetic partners. So you might have been, and there was also the slide that I was showing you before. So I just near to the end, and this is the normal search that you can do, but you can also extend in principle the idea. So for instance, you can focus on specific signal when you know what is the time frequency pattern of them. So for instance, when you choose which is just an idea where time is here and frequency is here. Imagine you know you are searching for compact binary connection, just to make an example. You know that they tend to ring up, to ring up in the time frequency. So you can focus on the signal that ring up. Or if you know that for some reason, some waveform ring down, you can just focus on this. And some example are in this paper when you search for intermediate binary or binary backhaul, or also you can extend this idea like to use alternative approaches. So this is a study in which the time frequency reconstruction of the signal was used to feed a neural network and was used to recognize the typical pattern of the compact binary connection. So the representation of the time frequency was converted to a matrix that feed the neural network and to know if you can improve your estimation. Or another example was done for the supernova because some supernova process mechanisms show in the time frequency a common behavior that is a sort of arc or inverse chirp. And this arch was used to feed another neural network to see if you can improve the efficiency. And in this paper, there are this first tentative of this, and you can see that the the method, this one was improving the standard CWB alone at the same level. So I want just to finish this. So we know that the astronomy of gravitational wave is starting. So we have a lot of events. Now it's easy to lose the count. And we know that the second part of the free run, and we still don't know exactly how many we have seen. For now, we have just seen compatible binary collections. So we hope to see something more in the future. And this is why this presentation was focused when you have not modeled transient search. So just be ready for everything. And in the different cases of algorithm that you can have, the collaboration is exploiting. I just report one of them, for example. But of course, we don't forget there are others. So now we just finish the third run. We are improving. We are in the commission to improving the detectors to start the next run or four. It's still difficult to say when it's starting really, because especially with the pandemic situation, sometimes you get delay. So hope to have to know in advance if we don't have too many delay. But we know that in principle we should have also a full detector network, because also Kaga promised to join the run with a sensitivity that can be interesting to be used in the analysis.